Server Component is a new proposal from the React team. It's not available on React yet, but you can try on an experimental branch of React. And I think it might change the way we create applications in the future. Let's take a look. I'll start with a disclaimer. Server Component was released in this experimental branch because it's not ready for prime time yet. The React team wants people to try it out and provide feedback, so when it actually reaches React officially, it might even be different from what you're seeing here. They even asked people to not post tutorials and videos online, but I think that with these disclaimers, we're safe to just explore a little bit. I will also link on the YouTube description links to the official docs that they released. Also, they released a very in-depth video, and also the link to the discussion that's happening on GitHub if you want to provide some feedback. This video is more like an overview of what the future might look like. So before even discussing potential benefits and how it's different from server-side rendering, let's dive directly into code and we'll go from there. So I have this sample bookstore of sorts. It's right now in traditional React, and I want to port it to server components. So I select a book, and it shows me the book details. That's all it does. If we take a look at the source code, it looks like this. I have the book details. It's the most important one that we'll deal with. It has this use effect. It receives a book ID as props, and then inside the use effect, it fetches the book details from the server. This is a very complete example using a board controller in case we choose a different book or we leave this component. We want to cancel the existing fetch that's going on. We have a state to control the loading state. And finally, we display the book details here. If I put this application in a graph, it will look like this. I have my app component. It loads both book list and book details. And book details fetch data from the server, and the server returns a JSON. And how is this different from actually using server components? Well, in server components, the whole book details component gets executed, gets rendered in the server. The server, the app component will request it, the server rend, realize that it needs some data, put data together, and send it back to the app, to the client in the browser. Does it send it back like in HTML? No, it uses this specialized data format that React created so that React back on the browser can very quickly append it to its own document, its own component structure, and then render it to the DOM. So it never gets actually rendered on the client. It renders on the server, and the client receives something pre-produced with coupled of component and data details so it can output to the DOM. So let's get this book details here and start porting it to my server components demo. I already have it started here. I have this book details.server.js. It's just empty, so I'm gonna paste it here. So the first thing that you realize is that in the server components demo, the components they're split into something that finishes, that ends with .server.js, and others end with .client.js. This is how it decides between what should render in the browser and what should render in the server. This is one of those things that might change. So whatever ends with .client.js, it's just regular React components. Whatever finishes with .server.js are the new server components. So what I'm gonna do here is, I do not need to control loading inside the component anymore, because in the server components model, it uses a React suspense. And who controls the loading state is the parent component. So as you can see here, I'm already loading the book details wrapped in the suspense component that controls whether to show or not the loading state. I also don't need the book because it's going to come in a different fashion. And I also don't need use effect. Here's how this is going to work. A server component is built on top of some recent React innovations, like, as I mentioned, suspense and concurrent mode. Which means that the way it loads data resembles synchronous code. It looks like this. I already have my DB set up here. db.server. And the way this works is that I can call db.query here. And there's a very clever mechanism here. This throws a promise and then React Suspense understands that it needs to wait for the promise to resolve before continue rendering this component. Of course, in a real use case, you will not do SQL commands directly. You'll probably use an abstraction such as on and or am. In my case here, I'm just going to do some SQL commands directly here. So I'm gonna say that const my book equals db.query. I'm gonna select everything from books. I already have a database running where ID equals, and I'm going to escape here the ID parameter, which I'm receiving as props here. This query returns an array of potential rows. Because I'm selecting by ID, I know that I'm only going to have one single return. So yeah, back here, I don't need this loading anymore. I can just go straight and render the book. Let's see if this works. I'll start the server here. Oh yeah, I don't have the similar books here anymore, or not yet. So I'm calling this out. I'm also not importing CSS directly here. I have a different setup for styles. So let's start again. Seems like it's working on port 4000. Back to the browser. There we go. If I select a book, it shows the book details. But now it's coming from the server. So let's start with some questions, answering some questions here and talking about advantages and disadvantages. So what's the difference between this and server-side rendering? It's a very common question, and the answer is, well, it really has nothing to do with server-side rendering. Server-side rendering, first, it usually happens when you first load the page or the application, and it's an illusion, right? You render all of your components in the server, render into HTML that you send back to the browser to give the illusion to the user that the content is already there, that the things are already running. But the browser still has to download all the JavaScript as execute React. React will also need to get access to the very same data, render all of your components again, just realize, oh, things are already on the DOM, I'm gonna skip the first render, and only then the application becomes interactive. With server components, I have some of my components running on the client and some of my components rendering on the server. So they are different things. What about advantages and disadvantages? Well, the first advantage is that because this component only ever runs on the server, it never gets bundled in the JavaScript that goes to the client. That's why when the React team released this, it called the zero bundle server components. I could even, for example, import and use a very heavy NPM library, and it would never, if I never use this on a client's component, it would never add to the bundle size. Besides that, it also brings you benefit, for example, in case you're doing dependent fetching, which is what I'm doing here with my similar books. So back on my traditional application, the similar books, it receives a list of tags and the ID of the current book as props, and it does a new fetch to fetch the similar books. Now, of course, in my simple application here, I shouldn't do this. I should just go on my main fetch and fetch all the data that I need. But I'm doing this to illustrate a real problem that happens in real applications. Maybe that your dependent fetch doesn't always happen. It's just when the user goes in a different, in a specific path. So it makes sense to do it as a dependent fetch. It doesn't really matter why. What matters is that this is a real problem. And it's a problem because by having two components here talk to the server, I have two complete round trips to the server. This takes a long time. If I were using server components, I can render the whole subtree inside my server. The server will start reading my book details, understand that it needs some data from the database, go and talk to the database, starts looking into the book details, also get some new data from the database. Yes, it's still talking to the database twice, but the most impactful thing that is happening are the round-trip connections to the user. So it already gives a better experience and a faster experience to the user. Besides, there are things that you can do later in your server to, for example, speed up your server, your database connections. For example, you could cache. But let's implement that. So I'm going to copy and paste my similar books code here back on my server components. Similar books.server.js. I'm going to paste it here. Again, I don't need to control loading. I don't need this piece of state to have the book. I don't need use effect. And again, I don't need to control loading. I can just go. And because I have a div there, I also don't need these. Much more simpler code. Now, I'm already dealing with CSS in a different way. So import from db.server. I'm going to copy and paste my SQL clause here to speed it up. Select all books, all everything from books where the tags match the tags that I'm passing here. And the ID is not the current book. This syntax here is specific to Postgres, which is the database that I'm using. Then I have a similar books, which I'm going to map through back here. I can uncomment this. And I can also import similar books from /similarbooks.server. Server is already running. Let's take a look. If I select a book, now I have the similar books in one single round trip to the server. If you're interested, if you're curious to know what gets sent to the client, let's inspect here. I'll go to the network tab. Let me try again. Let's get some books. And as you can see, what gets returned to the client is this data structure here and not some HTML. Awesome, isn't it? Are there disadvantages to this model? Yes, there are. Because the component, again, only ever runs on the server, you cannot have interactivity. You cannot have event handlers, for example, because, well, nobody's going to be clicking in the server. So what if I wanted, for example, to add a buy button in my book details that runs on the server? Well, you cannot add an event listener there, but server components can run client components, and you can just create the book button with the event handler in a client component, and React will figure it out what needs to be run on the server, what needs to run on the client, and provide the user with the actual experience. So let me show you. I'm back in my book similar books.server, and I want to add here my buy button. Because this runs on a server, I cannot buy a button, I cannot put a button directly here, so I'm going to create a new file that I'm going to call buybutton.client.js. Oh, looks like I already have it here. So buybutton, it's just a button with an add to cart, but it will run on the client. So back on my book details here, I'm going to import it. So import buybutton from buybutton.client. And I'm going to add it here. After the tags, I'm going to pass the book ID. I'm going to add an onClick event handler here. So when the user clicks, right now I'm just going to do a browser alert, just so we can see that it actually works on the client. So user clicked on book ID. And then let's get the ID here. Let's see if this works. I'm going to select a different book here. Add to cart. There we go. User clicked on book ID 3. So there you go, a very brief overview of what Server Components is and what it can do and the benefits that it brings. Don't forget to check the video that the React team created. It offers a more in-depth view, as well as the demo that they put together. The links are on the video description, and this demo that I made is on GitHub. github.com/cassiosn/reactcasts. If you like these videos, please subscribe. It will mean a lot to me, and see you on the next one.